Welcome to the Culture Edit, unique perspectives into the personal and professional lives of individuals at the helm of successful business, athletics, art, and design.
Have you seen the cat? I saw it on TikTok, a Maine Coon.
No.
There are these giant cats. They have like a snout like a dog.
Hmm.
And they live to be like 25 years old.
And you can get one or like yeah. They're wild animals?
No. They're like domesticated cat, a Maine Coon cat.
And they're like as big as and Hutch?
I think they said they're 35 pounds.
So
and they're
big
like
as
huge
any?
And they have like, they're like really chill.
Huh.
Yeah. They're like, and they play with dogs.
But can you walk them outside or do they have to use the bathroom in a litter box?
That wasn't included in the...
Because I don't like the litter box thing.
Yeah, I think it's litter box time.
Hmm. Yeah, I don't like that.
Yeah.
It's like the one thing that keeps me from getting a cat.
Yeah, it's kind of gross.
No matter what people say, if you have a cat with a litter box, unless you live in like a really big house where the cat has a full separate room, mm-hmm. your house smells like litter box.
Yeah.
And you just become nose blind to it. It's true though. Like, when have you ever walked
something
in?
To think about, Adam. We know you want a cat.
Well, that's why I was thinking he should just have like an outdoor cat.
Yeah.
But I think that'd be difficult.
Yeah.
In Copenhagen.
Yeah.
So episode 30, welcome to the Culture Edit.
Welcome.
Dive right in off that conversation around giant cats.
Yeah.
Speaking of animals, we have a really exciting episode this week, but before we get into
it's an animal-themed episode.
Animal-themed.
So we got a guest today.
Yeah, we have a guest today that I would say is like co-parented Hutch with us.
Hutch is our dog, of our dogs.
Yeah, Hutch is our Belgian Malinois. And so our guest today has been a friend since 2015 when we got Hutch. He is a celebrity dog trainer. He is a great person, great friend. Again, he's helped us so much with Hutch throughout the years. But Darius Daniels is our guest today, and he owns a company called PK9, Higher Powered Pets. And it's going to be really interesting because on this podcast, we dig into a lot of different industries and like the culture in those industries. But one thing I think dog training and protection training in this whole world that Darius lives in, and that is also a really big part of our lives too, even if people don't know about it. It's such an interesting world, and it's a lot bigger than people realize.
It's a huge culture.
So it's a pretty cool subculture within even the dog training culture.
So explain, because we don't really explain because we're just talking to Darius. Explain the different types of training that you can get with a dog, because there are a lot of people, especially I'd say even people in Atlanta, a lot of bad dogs in Atlanta.
Oh,
they don't
so
get
bad.
Trained at all. So, and by the way, this can be any kind of dog. It doesn't have to be Belgian Malinois. You'll hear us talk about that with Darius, but talk about the different types of training real quick.
I mean, I think, you know, again, like I just said, there's obedience training and then there's protection training. And so obedience training is more of like what it sounds like. Sit, stay, recall, heel, really focusing on the dog, communicating with your dog.
Yeah, training the person too.
Yeah, and it's really training you more than it is training the dog. I mean, we talk with Darius, like there's pretty much no dog that you can't train unless the dog is low IQ essentially.
Yeah.
But that's like a person, you know?
Yeah. It's not necessarily the breed, it's just the
person.
No,
it's like you could have like a really dumb dog that's supposed to be a smart breed, but they're just not. Like some dogs just aren't intelligent.
Yeah.
And so
when people see Hutch and like, oh my God, he's so well trained. Like if you ever notice, Hutch only walks on our left side. He can just come, you can just tell him left and he just sits down next to you left. Like everyone's like, oh my God, he's so well trained.
He knows hand signals.
Yeah, he does all the hand signals. The reason is because we went through this really advanced training.
Yeah. Yeah, I spent every weekend for about 2 years going to dog training with Hutch.
So what's protection training?
Protection training is, again, more focused on protecting the house, protecting the owner, and it's a lot of bite work. It's a lot of barking on command. There's a lot of running with different objects and suits and trying to throw the dog off with noises and sounds and all kinds of distractions.
But it is really about protecting the owner.
But it's been you know, it was actually a really, it was, well, I was spending a lot of my time doing this before I even became a cyclist. So it was actually a huge, huge part of my life for years. You were traveling basically Monday through Friday for your job, and there was some home invasions in the townhomes next to us. And I just was so scared that I was like booby trapping the house. I didn't grow up with weapons, so I didn't feel comfortable. Then we spoke with one of our friends who's a police officer, and he's like, well, if you have the time, you're working from home, why don't you get a shepherd and, you know, go through the protection training thing? So it made sense at that time in our life. Luckily we bring the dogs with us every day to the office. So
one, it's made a huge, I think, impact in terms of just how you felt lifestyle wise to have Hutch.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I feel it's totally, if I have Hutch with me, I'm not scared of anything.
Yeah.
Like, he's the man of all men. That's what we call him.
Yeah.
He's sitting right next to me right now, and he's dreaming.
Yeah, he is dreaming.
Chasing the bennies.
So, yeah, so we'll go through that. So, you know, Darius, he's an entrepreneur. We'll talk through that.
Hustler
to build his business. He's a brand builder. Mm-hmm. Like, when you think about someone who's really focused on their brand, PK9, he's hyper-focused on his
brand. It was the first time we had an interviewee show up with, like, a photographer and, like, other people to,
We had an audience.
Yeah, yeah. So it was really fun. He's definitely, like, a brand builder, really into social media, and just an all-around great business mind.
Yeah, and he's a good dude.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
All right, well, with that, do we want to hop into it?
Let's go.
Let's do it.
Are we on air?
I'm recording, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. That's perfect. Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, now I'm originally from PG County.
Okay. I know that.
So that's right outside of D.C.
Oh, cool.
I feel like you go to Dallas a lot, though, or Houston.
I go to Houston a whole lot.
Okay.
That's where, like, honestly, if I had to pack up and go, that would be probably my next destination.
Really?
Huh.
Yeah. Why?
I haven't been to Houston.
I mean, because
I have. A lot of concrete.
Yeah, a lot of concrete. But it's also, you know, I'm still like to go out and things like that and enjoy different cultures. So Houston still got a good, you know, it's a mix of cultures that's out there.
Yeah.
The cost of living is a lot more inexpensive compared to here.
Yeah.
Only thing about Houston is the floods.
Oh, yeah.
And that's a...
It's real.
Yeah,
real bad.
Yeah. Yeah, I actually got caught in a flood out there. Was it Imelda?
It a couple years ago?
Yeah.
I remember that. I remember seeing it on your Instagram.
That's right.
Yeah.
And you were like helping save people with your truck.
Yeah. I was out there with Trader Truth. Shout out to Trader Truth out there in Houston. He's actually an artist out there and an activist and an array of other things too.
Yeah.
So I was out there with him with his dog, and then next thing you know it, the storm comes, and then we putting on our water. He asked me, could I swim? And I was like, oh, yeah, I can swim. So he had passed me the water, like the little one piece with the boot with the hose, so I won't get wet.
Yeah, waders.
Yeah. Then we got out there right in the streets. That was actually a crazy but amazing experience because water was like up to your chest.
Yeah.
In the cul-de-sac.
Yeah, that's wow. And like cars are like floating by you.
Most definitely.
That's crazy. Like,
so we actually went at night. We actually dealt with the homeless and took them to Mattress Mack. Y'all familiar with Mattress Mack?
No, what's that?
So do you remember when the Houston won the World Series?
Yes.
He was actually the guy who put, I think it was $1 million before the season started.
You're right.
And his payout was
super
crazy.
So it's this old guy that owns like a retail mattress company, right?
Yes. Well, it's a furniture store.
Yeah. Were taking the people
to like his store?
To his,
yes. Okay. We was taking them straight from downtown. We met them right outside the library.
Yeah.
And picked them up. We had about 3-4 trucks, pickup trucks, you know, lifted all the way up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They was in the back, you know, we kind of fit them on how we had to fit them on. The ladies first, kids, ladies and kids first, families and things like that. And get them out there to Mattress Mack store.
That's wild. Yeah.
That's cool. No, normally when you're there, though, you're there for work.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. There for work. Like a lot. I have a whole lot of clients that's out there. So just to name a few, I don't know. Have you heard of the restaurant Turkey Leg Hut?
Turkey? No.
All right, so turkey leg cut. So they do stuffed turkey legs. I mean, they
Nikki hates turkey. That's why we don't know about turkey.
I had a turkey leg one time. It was at Disney.
Oh, because
you know how they have those big turkey legs.
Nah. So look, all right. So
I don't hate turkey.
All right, so
yeah, you do.
So okay, guess what? I got something for you.
Okay.
So the next time, whenever you decide to go to Houston, go to
turkey leg hut.
All right.
Yeah. Okay.
And you definitely gonna have a different, because you didn't get it done right.
No, it's because sorry, Mom, if you're listening to this, but
here we go.
Like, turkey at the holidays was dry. It was dry. And didn't have a lot of seasoning on it. And I was always just like, I can't eat this. This is brutal. And so then I just never really have had good turkey. I think that's the problem.
Yeah.
Okay.
So is that a client then? That's yes. Why you're going out there?
Yes. Yeah. He's one of my clients. He bought probably about three dogs.
Yeah.
Three dogs from me, adult dogs. So, you know, and also I trained his other dogs that he had also. So he has like a ranch and all that good stuff like that. Everything's big in Texas.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
So, yeah.
So let's rewind a little bit. Welcome to the Culture Edit, Darius.
Hey.
Glad to have you here.
Thank you. I really appreciate you all inviting me on you all's platform.
Yeah,
it's awesome.
We're super excited.
I can say, because I can hear, you two can't hear, but Darius has this really good radio voice. I thought my voice was
like
good. So I'm getting a little jealous now.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're excited. We were like thinking about it. We're just like, who is like operating in a world where like a lot of people don't necessarily know a whole lot about that world, but it impacts, like it's impacted our lives more than anything.
Completely.
Yeah. I mean, it's
changed
like
our lives.
And then we even, you know, not at the level you are, but try to pass some of that knowledge on to our friends who have other dogs.
Yeah.
And so we're like, who has like a cool business? And then we thought of you, but like walk us through, I remember you telling me like how you got into it, but walk us through how you got into essentially dog training, protection, and eventually building this amazing brand.
Yeah. So pretty much to sum it up, in, let's say, high school, middle school, I was my barber. Shout out Nardo. He was the one who introduced me to the working dog. And that's, so in Maryland, where I'm from, we had a lot of cane corsos, Presbyterians, band dogs, dog Argentinas, like a lot
scary dogs.
A lot of your big, larger dogs, because it was at one point in time illegal to own a pit bull terrier, so they did other breeds, and my barber had me run down the field, and like back in the day, it was like a Michelin man suit, and he'd just send a dog.
So not even a real professional suit, just like
it was a real professional suit, but it's like I'm very small. I mean,
middle school.
Okay, yeah,
like,
yeah.
It's middle school, so we would go to Kenmore Middle, right in Capitol Heights, and then we'd go out there in the back, and it'd be everybody with their working dogs. So you have a guy that's all the way over there with his German Shepherds doing whatever, and then you have other groups of people out there with puppies, trying to get them worked and conditioned. And at that point in time, it was just something to do. I was infatuated with dogs, animals per se.
Yeah.
So I didn't look at it like a profession or a job. So the key turned once I graduated from college and moved to Atlanta and linked up with a guy by the name of Phil, which is my uncle's best friend. Rest in peace, Phil. And Phil is actually from Houston. So he was actually the person who really introduced me to Texas.
Okay.
So Phil had bought a dog. Maybe he's probably spent about $10,000-$15,000 for the dog.
Wow.
And probably like another $5,000-$10,000 on training.
Yeah.
And then me living on the couch, trying to figure out what I'm doing, working at the club and all that stuff like that, which was cool. I was like, okay, all right, there's money to be made. So I just kind of picked up something that I once did for a pastime and then turned it into a business. And then as far as like my business aspect of it, which I definitely pride myself more on, it just comes from just being a person who've never filled out a job application or went on a job interview ever in my life.
I was going to ask you that. Have you ever had a normal job?
No way. I got hired at a pet store, but it was only because me and the owner's dog had the same birthday.
Okay.
So that was the job. And then, so it was just something to pass time. But as far as like me as an adult, trying to get into the work field, I never even thought about it. I just was psychologically, I was just like, let me figure out what I like and what I don't mind doing every day. And yeah, it was the dogs after me hearing about how much Phil paid for the dog plus the trainer.
Yeah.
And then I just utilized my resources from the club to kind of narrow in on my clientele base.
How early in your creation, because like when we were working with you,
yeah,
Craig was in the picture with K9 Boss.
Yep.
And how early kind of in the PK9 brand were you at that point? Because this was a while ago. This was like 2015.
Yeah. It's 2014.
Or 2014,
15.
Yeah.
Yeah, 2014, 15. I was initially training at the park. Mm-hmm. And then I, you know, in my mind, I just knew that I needed to get into like a facility area, something that'll bring clientele in without me having to bring clientele in. That's going to be just coming in. I linked up with Craig.
Yep.
And then we had created Atlanta Canine Solutions.
Yep.
So Atlanta Canine Solutions, it was 50-50. So it was me, Craig, and I that was in the business together with Atlanta Canine Solutions. But, you know, in all actuality, it was like Atlanta Canine Solutions, like, I guess you would say the tree, and then, like, the limbs were, like, PK9 and K9 Boss.
Yeah.
So then after that, we went our ways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then, you know, just...
That's when you went to Godby Road.
No. We was on Godby Road together for Atlanta K9 Solutions.
Oh, so
right. Yeah. Okay. After they sold the building on Godby Road, that's when I was at the park training.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because I was trying to figure out a location. I can't even remember the park. It was right over there on.
But it was it over by Godby Road, like near Old National?
Close. Oh, yeah. Okay. Close. It was a super park. I actually before this.
Stranger Things.
Shot Stranger Things over there. So as I'm training there at the park, people are coming there to take pictures in front of the pool.
From Stranger Things.
Crazy. I rode my bike by Godby yesterday.
Okay.
And I thought about that when I rode by and I got back. And first of all, you know why I like to go that route?
Why?
Because people look at me like I'm crazy.
They do. They're
riding
like,
down Old National.
Yeah.
They look at me like I am nuts.
Yeah.
And they just like give me right. They like just let me go right
through
the
middle. Why is this skinny guy riding down the highway? Like, what's happening?
Yeah. I mean, you know, it's you definitely stand on like a sore thumb.
I do. But I got back and I had like a memory. It was like 3 years ago. It was 3 years to the day whenever I'd stopped.
Yeah.
When you guys were all outside. All
I was like, a picture.
Exactly. Yeah. I was all like,
that was crazy because it was just by like, we do that route a lot and we like saw the sign, but you hadn't been out there the past couple times we'd ridden by.
Mm-hmm.
And we were like, maybe they're inside. And then that one time y'all were outside.
He's outside and I'm like.
It was so crazy. Yeah. It was really crazy. Cool.
That was dope. That was dope. That was dope. That was actually around the time I flirted with the cycling phase.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
But I got a nice bike. I got a decent bike.
Yeah, I know.
It's carbon.
You told me. Yeah,
it's cool.
You need to ride
it
though.
When you came down to the Beltline.
Yes.
I saw. Is it BMC?
Trek.
That's right. Yes. Trek.
Yeah. You talked to me about an idea I still think is genius.
Which one?
Putting the clips, the cleats on Jordans.
Right.
I was like, that's a million dollars. Like, especially in Atlanta.
Yes.
You just got to figure out how to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, honestly, I think that'll go platinum.
It would.
Because it'll bring a different swagger. Because, I mean, y'all look cool as hell when y'all be riding.
Yeah.
And I know y'all aim for being looking cool as hell because everybody else be looking cool as hell.
Right. That's the name of the game.
Yeah. With a proper shoe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sky's the limit.
Do you ever ride with the dope peddlers?
That's who I actually was riding with for a second. Like whenever we'll just have like some extra time, we'll do that. I think it was like a Wednesday or Thursday night ride. We'll meet up downtown and go to the airport and come back all the way around.
I think it's their Wednesday night ride.
Yeah.
I think it was Wednesday night. Yeah. Wednesday night ride. Yeah. Just like you all riders, like they ride with damn near the same people.
Every single weekend.
Every weekend for years.
Yeah.
So that's how it builds. It's like you meet people through cycling and then you're like, I can't stop because now this is my like core friends.
Right.
And even if you don't necessarily hang out with people off the bike, like on the bike, you've spent so much time together for years. Right. You're like, this is like my family, my bike family.
Right. And that was around that time, that was actually, I did my birthday in Colorado and it was probably about 10 of us, and we all rented bikes and rode for like probably about, what was that, 4 miles or so?
Yeah.
Because we were sitting all the breweries and wineries and all the stuff like that, and going up the hill, down the hill. Just imagine 10 people.
Yeah.
And I'm probably like one of the only person. Oh, me and BJ was probably like the only people who was riding at that time. So everybody was like, yo, what are we doing?
They were dying.
Yes.
Because you're at altitude probably too. So it's so hard to breathe.
Most definitely. Yeah. And that's a real thing. You really don't realize how different it is until you actually put yourself in that position.
Yeah. And it takes a while.
It's easy to sit in that car and be like, oh, look at that. That's easy. Like, why don't they get out of my way?
It takes a while to acclimate. And you're like, oh, man, this feels twice as hard than it does in Atlanta.
So when y'all riding and you know that you're blocking up the lane, do y'all know that you're blocking up the lane, or do y'all just be like,
y'all try
to look past?
It depends. So we got different like strategies around it. If it's a dangerous road, we'll take the lane to be more safe.
Yeah.
Like to block. Like they'll just deal with it.
Yeah.
Because the like them trying to pass, especially if it's really tight and there's other cars coming, that's how we end up getting hit. So we'll take the lane on purpose.
Although what we will do is if it's like a really long, like single lane, you know, or double lane road, once we get to a point where we can pull off, like we'll have the group pull over and let all the cars go.
Mm.
That way we're not like for miles just like slowing up traffic.
Yeah.
But
we try to do the routes so we don't have to do that.
Yeah.
We try to do the routes so it's big enough to where if we're in the lane, they can easily go around us. Just because we skipped over real quick, I remember you telling a story like when you worked at the club.
Yeah.
You realized that having a dog was more beneficial for your protection than any dude behind you having a gun.
Most definitely.
Yeah.
Most definitely. A dog cannot be bribed.
Right.
When trained properly. In the nightclub industry, you're dealing with unbalanced people. And not necessarily unbalanced people. Naturally, is unbalanced because you got alcohol, you got drugs. And y'all in this settings is volatile situation. Not volatile, I mean, I guess you would say.
But it could be.
Yeah, it could be. It's just like a mosh pit. So with an animal, is like, it kind of allow get people to think first. Because if I had a gun on me, they'll still try me. As opposed if I was walking with Hutch. Shout out Hutch. So if I was walking with Hutch, the person would have to think twice.
Yeah.
I mean, because it's an animal, so it's kind of, it's a little different. Also, at times, we all may be just not paying attention. A dog is always paying attention.
So
if I'm reaching into my glove compartment or anything like that, my dog is catching my left while I'm looking to my right.
We were just talking to these two cops from Chicago.
Okay.
It's for work.
One of our clients is like a big security, like off-duty officer company nationwide.
And they said almost exactly what you just said. They were like, when we're working downtown Chicago, like we've got guns, bad guys got guns. We don't care. Like we shoot each other.
They're both canine handlers too.
But a dog comes out and it's like a whole different ballgame. They're like, I'm afraid of the dog. Yeah. Well, then I'm afraid of someone shooting a gun at me.
Yeah. And that's very much true. It's like we utilize the dogs as like our first line of defense. So even a dog that's in the house is like bark and let me know that something strange is going on or somebody's at the door or the pizza man is there so I can handle myself accordingly.
Yeah. Our neighbors say that we have the safest house in Inman Park.
Definitely.
Because of how much he barks.
Yeah.
It's a lot.
Yeah.
He hates UPS.
Yeah. I mean, I'll take that over just, you know, somebody being able to just break all the way in while I'm upstairs in the shower.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
Walk us through the psychological, because I think the coolest thing, so I trained with you for probably like 2 years. On and off. Like at first we were going like every single weekend I was going to training and then like going back and practicing. And that's what people will say, like, how is Hutch so good? And I was like, it can take years. Like
Most definitely. Can
do short, but like if you really want to keep up with it, you know, it's kind of the best way.
Yeah.
But one of the coolest things I think that I learned is the way to properly communicate with someone or something that doesn't speak English.
Right.
And
right.
So it's like I'll hear like in the neighborhood, this like this woman, she has this little West Highland Terrier. It's really cute, but the dog is so bad. And she'll be like, you need to stop right now doing what you're doing and blah, 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 blah. And I want to be like, ma'am, like this dog has no idea. Your voice sounds like you're rewarding him because you're like talking really nicely. And even though you're saying you're a bad boy, like that's, I might as well be saying you're a good boy. Right. And that's all they hear.
It's the same thing. I mean, the, like you would say, open line of communication between dog and handler. And with people who talk to their dogs like that, they haven't associated a reaction to an action, or they don't have no boundaries with their dog.
Yeah.
Their dog don't understand that they're not doing the right thing. So pretty much with their type of handlers, they just reinforcing bad behavior inadvertently though.
Yeah.
But that's where we come in handy, is where we teach the owner to properly communicate with a dog or any or animal, period.
Mm-hmm.
Like you said, something that doesn't talk your language. Body language.
Yeah, I remember when we first started working with you, you said, we can train the dog, but really it's about training you.
Most definitely.
The handler.
Most definitely. And that's key.
Yeah.
I mean, the dog is easy. It's changing somebody who's repetitious, been doing this thing for X amount of years to stop what they're doing.
Yeah.
It's a tough thing.
Where did you learn, like, that methodology? Because, like, and I want to get into, like, your take on the different methodologies of dog training. Because in, like, in America, it's not super regulated. Like in Europe, they have like processes to be a dog trainer, all that stuff.
I want to come back to European dogs. We'll come back.
Yeah, we'll come back to that because it's
most definitely.
Yeah.
But where did you learn, or like, I don't know, how did you decide on your methodology for training through PK9? Because I think it's unique compared to a lot of other dog trainers in Atlanta.
Yeah. So pretty much, I weigh heavily on communicating with the owner. I'm a psychology major, and I graduated honors, Psychi International Honor Society. So we did studies and things like that, et cetera. So action, reaction, all these, you know, all these things that you can apply to humans, you can apply to an animal through trial and error.
Mm-hmm.
I've been on it for a while now, so I kind of see what works best for certain dogs and what wouldn't work for certain dogs. And the only way you get good is when you deal with a substantial amount of dogs, just like the bike. Only way you get good is if you hit the pavement.
Yep.
I mean, it's part of the game. So I can't say it came naturally to me, but through trial and error and just, I guess you would say, repetitious behavior is the father of learning.
Yeah.
So repetitiously going through this, dealing with different dogs, dealing with different people, different personalities, different ways of people learning. Because some people are more visual, some people are more hands-on. Some dogs are a little bit more food-driven. Some dogs are a little bit more ball-driven, you know what I'm saying, or just love, period, driven. So you have to find out what works. And the only way you're able to find out what works best is dealing with a substantial amount of different people and dogs.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really no one answer, because the only reason why is it just take time. It just take time with anything.
So you're figuring out, okay, what drives the dog?
Yes.
But then how do I get this person to interact with that, what's driving them the best way?
Most definitely.
Yeah.
And that's what I think I specialize with. But I just do a very good job at communicating with owners and reassuring owners and making them feel comfortable about handling in their dog. And also, I tend to lean towards more of the extreme cases, the cases where it's option to go to the pound, or this dog may be deemed to get, you know, euthanized because it's not balanced.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's where we come into play and work on behavior modification.
Yeah.
That's what we really specialize in, a lot of behavior modification. To do what not to do, pretty much boundaries and limitations.
Yeah.
Have you ever come into a situation where someone brings a dog and you're just like, this dog cannot be trained, it cannot be overcome, like it can't unlearn things that it's learned?
It's not necessary. I've never came across a dog that can't learn new tricks, but I have came across owners who don't want to allocate the proper time to getting this dog to where it needs to be at.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's not necessarily the dog.
They want the easy button.
Most definitely.
Yeah.
It's the microwave method, I guess.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and people feel as though is that, and what I have an issue with like some of the clients who are super successful in their personal life, they think that transitions to the dog.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. In all actuality, the dog just want love and commitment and you know, just the regular things that has nothing to do with financial.
Yeah. Yeah, it doesn't care if it lives in a mansion or studio apartment. It just doesn't matter.
Or it don't care if you've spent $15,000, $20,000, $50,000 for the dog. If you're not putting the proper nurturing on the dog, it's just a dog.
Yeah. That's the challenge.
We do say, though, like when people are like, oh, should I get a protection dog or should I get a, you know, a really a big dog, like a shepherd or a cane corso?
Yeah.
We always say, like, if you have a job, because I do think this is part of it, too. Mm. If you have a job where you can't spend a good amount of time at home with the dog, it's probably not the best dog, because you just can't, like, the reason he's so chill is because he comes everywhere with us. And not saying you have to, like, bring your dog everywhere. There's obviously, but if you're at work from, you know, 6 a.m. till midnight, like, the dog is just going to be in a crate. It's going to act completely crazy when you let it out, no matter what.
Yeah. And I you know, what I'm about to say now, a lot of people don't say it. But I personally believe that people who work a lot and, you know, have jobs that require their time, a little bit more time, I think they should adopt older dogs. I don't think a puppy is for, I guess you would say, a single person. Puppies are for family. Because it requires a village. To properly do the things that it needs to be done, as far as like repetitiously taking the dog out for a bathroom. You know, boundaries, limitations inside the house as far as like a few eyes looking whether or not the dog is eating up on a sofa or anything like that. So with people who have jobs and, you know, a lot of things that require time away, is older dogs is the key. And you don't necessarily, I mean, when I say adopt, that doesn't mean go to the shelter. I mean, just if any older dog that's of age, that's over 7-8 years old, those are like golden years. And that's the dogs that's past the puppy phase, they passed the mid teenage phase, they passed the whole I'm the boss phase. And now it's just they just coasting.
And there's so many, like, I follow this mount or like shepherd rescue out in, I think they're in San Diego. But there's so many Mals and Dutchies just like constantly being surrendered at like 7 years old. And I'm like, man, like that's the, like, if you've never had a shepherd before, you should start with the older dog and then you'll understand the breed better and then get the puppy later if you have time.
I mean, that's, it's, I think 7 year old dog, that's golden. I'll take it any day.
So do you, because I was on your website, do you primarily focus more on obedience now over protection, or are you still doing both?
I do lean more towards the obedience side of things because I am still a business owner, and obedience is everybody needs obedience.
It's the bread and butter.
It's the bread and butter. A lot of people don't necessarily require protection side of things or don't see the, I guess you would say, the perks of it.
The value.
Of having a protection dog. So everybody who walks through the building is automatically going to start with obedience. So that's what I like to promote. And plus, with doing protection, it's just...
It's misunderstood,
I think. It's extremely misunderstood because you have some people that say, if I do protection with my dog, can I still go out with my dog? And I'm like, all right, if I do MMA, am I not allowed to go to the club? Or am I not allowed to go out to a park? I mean, am I just going to tweak out for no reason?
That's what people say about Hutch. They're like, oh, he's protection. Like, can he leave the house? I'm like, yeah, that's the thing, because he's obedient and protection. Like, he's not going to just lose his mind for no reason. Now, if you, like, run at me like crazy or something, course.
It's going down.
But, like, no one's going to hopefully do that. I also feel like with these, like, with especially shepherds, what I've realized is I think if you train them in obedience, they have such a natural drive to protect their pack anyways. That, like... I mean, it was really great to, like, do all of the protection stuff. And it was a great, honestly, like, lesson for me. Just really, I think everyone should understand what these dogs are capable of. Because I think if you understand what dogs are capable of, you have a lot more respect for them.
Most definitely.
And I think that's a huge problem, especially, like, and we can talk about Europe, but, like, especially in America, people do not respect dogs. Like, they go up to, like, I will never, I think of Shaq. I'm like, I will never
scariest dog I've ever seen.
Go up to like a random, like just I won't go up to random dogs now and be like petting them everything. It's very rare. Like I'll be like, can I pet your dog? But most of the time I don't even ask because I'm like, I don't want to risk it.
I mean, you're at the point now, you're paying attention to mannerisms. So your information is processing a little bit different than the average person walking around, because you're looking at different things that the average person not looking at. So you'll know whether or not this dog is going on the friendlier side, or more like we just waiting to bait you in to get closer
100%.
To you.
100%. Yeah. And it's funny because Emmy, obviously, she's a dog. She has always been really good at, like, she's just scared of everything. So, but she'll see dogs and immediately know if they're friendly or not. And I can actually tell at the same time as her now.
Yeah.
We get like the same. But same vibes. Same vibes. Whereas, same like, vibes, other people would be like, oh, it looks really nice. I'm like, no, that might be a golden retriever, but it's going to bite you.
Most definitely.
It doesn't matter what it is.
It doesn't matter. I respect every dog, from small dogs to large dogs. I mean, if I see it, I say, oh, nice dog. Or if I don't know the breed, I'll ask what's the breed. But I feel like the dog is like somebody's child.
Yeah.
So you wouldn't walk up to somebody's child and say, oh, nice hair.
Yeah. Can I pet your child?
Yeah. It's one of those things, like, you still got to respect. But the thing is, what's crazy about it is, if I tell somebody, hey, no, you can't pet my dog, and then they decide to pet my dog and my dog bites them, I'm in trouble.
Yeah.
We've had that a couple of times happen to us.
It's actually, especially when it's parents with kids and they're like, can my kid pet your dog? And I'm like, no, I'd rather you not. He's, you know, training or working or whatever.
Yeah.
And they'll be like, oh, that doesn't matter. And like, let their kid pet it anyways. And I'm like, he's not going to bite a kid. But like, if he did, now it's on, like, I told you no, you still broke that barrier and I'm still responsible. And it's just, again, it's to that respect. Like, people respect dogs.
Yeah, and it's a bad thing to even teach a child to just go up to anything like that. You lose the fear, I guess you would say, the fear of dogs. And not necessarily you're supposed to have a fear, but it's a level of respect.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's what needs to be taught. So even like a client buys a dog and they say the dog is getting aggressive. I just had a baby, right? Hypothetically speaking, if I have a client that just had a baby and they saying the dog, we have to figure out what's going on with the dog. The dog is not accepting the baby, or the bait, you know what I'm saying, or vice versa. I think that's not cool, because I think you have to teach the dog to be around a baby. And I also believe the baby has to learn not to do things to the dog.
Exactly. Yeah.
Like pulling at the tail, ears.
And like, as a parent, like, why do you, I never understand parents that leave their kid, like little kids, alone with a dog in a room.
Never.
Like, it doesn't matter, like, because the kid can't communicate with the dog can't communicate with the kid.
Nope.
It's your job to manage that.
Yeah.
And it's crazy.
Yeah, and it's not personal.
Yeah.
Kids get bit all the time. It's not personal. It's more, we have to be, well, the humans, we lack any compassion that has anything other to do with us.
Yeah.
So it's like when a kid get bit, is like, it's World War IV on a dog, but like nobody's gonna say, all right, what did the kid do? Did the kid grab the dog gonads? Did the kid grab the dog toes or ears?
Pull its ears.
Or go around a piece of food or play with the dog toy.
Yeah. Lay down on Hutch's hips and see what happens.
Oh gosh. If you touch his hips, it's not good.
Yeah,
it's going down. But that's, as respectable owners, y'all like, okay, I understand where my boundaries and limitations lie.
Yeah,
exactly.
And that's cool, because it's still an animal at the end of the day.
Yeah.
And we have to respect that, just like we would respect a lion, you know, or a bear.
Yeah.
A dog is, they, you know, before we domesticated them, I mean, they're still wild dogs. They living amongst them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We were talking about how, whenever we're like, we'll go to Europe maybe like once a year or something, and when we're there,
we're like, we can't wait to talk to you about this.
Yeah,
because we know you go to Europe too. And like, you
because you pretty recently were in Europe, and we're like, why are the dogs so much better in like bigger European cities than they are here in America?
Look,
they're so good. I don't,
you know, the
it.
Crazy thing about it is being over there and going to the parks and just engulfing myself inside the culture. Because I was over there for a while. So, and plus, my type of personality is not going to allow me to be an outsider.
Yeah.
I got to see what's going on. I got to be part of the culture. I got to learn, steady learning. And I did see that. When we at the park, the dogs are not running down on each other. Like, they might sniff and they go another way. Even the average person is saying here, and the dog's just coming back to them, and they walking in the park loose.
Yep.
I think the culture is different. I think us in America are predominant. And that is on all levels.
Yeah.
Via the government, or, you know what I'm saying? Leagues, we're super dominant. In other countries, that it's not a dominant thing. They're not walking around with guns.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And when you get in trouble out there, it's a little different. It's not
a battle.
Yeah. It's, you did this, now this is this. And on a smaller scale, it's like I racked up probably about $1,500 in tickets. You know what I'm saying? That's from just like parking.
Like parking tickets?
Yeah, okay. Parking or just speeding.
Yeah.
But nobody pulled me over. Right. It was more cameras. Just cameras.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They got more cameras per square footage than anywhere else in the United States. Anywhere in the United States.
Was it this in the UK? Yes. In London? Okay.
Yeah. Yes. London is camera city. So
we need that.
Highways is 30 miles per hour, 20 miles per hour, 10 miles per hour, and things like that. So back to what the conversation at hand is, psychologically, they're not into dominating things. So, and that's not what dogs need. Dogs need a clear communication. It's like, so it doesn't derive from anger. It's just more just understanding.
Yeah. It makes so much sense. Take it back to what I was saying about the neighbor who has the little dog.
Yeah.
And she's all about yelling. I mean, yeah. She just constantly is yelling at the dog. And of course, that's not going to change the behavior.
Jerking around its leash.
And the dog never changes.
Yeah.
But that's that, like, the only way we know how to communicate is we think we're communicating at the dog to change behavior instead of understanding why is this dog doing this, though?
Right.
And maybe it's something I'm doing. Maybe it's something in the environment. Like, I need to change the environment and take it out of the environment and then introduce it back in a different way.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's such an interesting – I never thought of it like that. Like, America – it is very much about everyone is dominating their own space and their own things, and that's how we communicate versus accepting that it's like something different.
What's at hand.
Yeah.
That's my take on it.
Yeah, it's the owners.
It's the owners. It's the psyche of the owner. It's more of like understanding as opposed to dominance. You're going to get more work with understanding as opposed to less work with dominance.
What breed would you say, this is a little bit off topic, but I want to ask this thing, is the most difficult to train?
And what's your most favorite?
Okay. So to answer the first part of the question is pretty much the breed that's most difficult is not necessarily a breed, but it's the mental capacity of the dog.
Yeah.
The drive of the dog, the willingness to learn, the willingness to obey.
Mm-hmm.
That's the difference. So the worst dog to train is probably a dog with bad genetics. The best dogs to train are dogs with good genetics, because I can have a Yorkie that's super attentive and highly trainable, but then I can go with like a Maltese that's not looking at me in my eyes, not food motivated, doesn't care too much about toys, and just pretty much like a dull dog. So I guess the best dogs to train is the ones that's a little bit more, have more drive.
Smart.
Yeah. Yeah, smart. Yeah. I mean, want to learn.
Yeah.
My favorite dog is like, I guess you would say a KMPV Dutch Shepherd.
Okay.
Or a dog with brindle stripes.
Yeah.
So in London, well, the UK and all everywhere else outside of the United States, they don't necessarily classify the dogs with brindle Dutch.
Yeah.
They just call it a herder. So the brindle dogs and the brindle dogs that has gone through the sport KMPV or going through the sport of KMPV.
What is that?
KMPV is a sport that in Europe, that's only exercised in Europe.
Oh, yeah. It's like some biting.
Like
in the
Netherlands. Stuff like that. Yeah. So it's like it's a hard sport.
Yeah.
They apply a lot of pressure on the dogs.
Mm-hmm.
They might breed a Malinois to a pit bull, maybe back to a Malinois to a Czech Shepherd.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Just to create an ultimate dog.
Yeah.
And so that's where I will lean towards, because I want an ultimate dog.
Yeah.
I want a dog that when we go to the park, I'm throwing a ball, they jump in the water. When we on an elevator escalator, it's genetically just going to, even if it's never done it before, it's going to just tap into what, you know what I'm saying, works best.
Yeah.
So I will go with a KMPV herder.
Hutch has everything but the jumping in the water part.
Yeah.
He can't swim.
One time he forgot that he couldn't swim, and I threw a ball in the water, and he jumped in, and he started swimming. But then as soon as he realized that, like, he was in the water, he freaked out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's not a swimmer.
But that's good, though. I mean, his drive took him over to jump into the water. Yeah. And I'll take that. That's step one. Like, just like with you all in cycling, you all get tired, but you dig down deep. It's the drive that says, all right, I got to keep going. I got to keep going. So that's what I look for. That's good genetics.
Yeah. Yeah.
Good genetics is not allowing yourself to completely fold when during in confrontation situations, yeah, or not being able to calculate, not panicking in certain situations.
So I see you even train Frenchies. I didn't even know they could be trained.
Yeah. You know, honestly, Frenchies are just like little Malinois.
Yeah.
Really?
Wow.
I promise you.
You used to have one.
I had one. But
yeah.
For real?
He wasn't that smart.
Yeah, maybe not. Well,
he was lazy.
Yeah. But it was, yeah, he was lazy.
He was late. Yeah, he wasn't like, this was a long time ago before they were popular.
Okay.
And so they didn't act like Frenchies today. They weren't like super wound up. They were more like English Bulldogs.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now it's like, I actually got one at the house now that I'm training, and I have one at the facility that I'm training. And they're super high drive dogs.
Yeah. Yeah.
What's up?
We have a friend that's got one that's high drive.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Smokey.
Shout out to Smokey.
Shout
out to Smokey.
She's so cute.
Yeah.
I remember, well, I don't know if they're considered bulldogs. So I laugh about this in my mind because like, you probably don't remember this, but one of the first times I was going to like the farm to bring Hutch to do the training, it was like, a few guys were there and they had these like little bully dogs, like the fancy ones.
Yeah.
The short ones.
The little short ones.
What are those called?
Bullies.
They're just bullies?
Micro bullies.
Micro bullies.
Yeah. Okay. With the screw tails.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
And they're I remember like one time I was like, we were talking and you're like, oh yeah, those guys, like they're rappers.
Shout out to Migos. Raindrops. Drop top.
Smoking, no cooking, the hot box. Cooking. That's
Yeah. So that was, I think.
But it was kind of like maybe before they were like blowing up.
Most definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Most definitely. That was when everybody lived in, you know what I'm saying, one house.
Yeah.
You know, everybody was trying to figure it out.
But I think about it now and I'm like, because we were training at the same time when they had their little boys and we were training Hutch. And I was like talking to these guys, but I didn't know, like, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking now, I'm like, wow, that's so crazy. Like how in that short period of it, I was just like, that's really cool. Like how people can just blow up that much.
Fast. Yeah. That's, and you know, that was actually, I guess you would say, one of my first big client.
That's what, that's what I was thinking.
Yeah,
like,
my first big client. And we kind of watch each other kind of matriculate through this whole thing called life. Because initially, how we initially met was them buying sections at our club, Mansion Elon.
Uh-huh.
And then it went from them buying sections at the club to us giving them sections. And then it goes from us giving them sections and bottles to us paying them to come to the club.
Wow. It's a big swing.
Yeah. So we kind of watched through the whole process.
Yeah.
And that was dope because it kind of gave me like a battery pack because it's a little difference when you see it.
Yeah.
That means you can achieve it.
Yeah.
And now we ride our bikes by Offset and Cardi B's house.
We do. Yeah.
Every week.
All the time.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep.
There's like so much security.
Are most of your high profile clients, are they getting protection dogs? Or are they just want their dogs trained? Obedience.
Most of them really just want their dogs trained.
Yeah.
Why? Because they move around a lot and they like the illusion of protection. They like, so they might get a mile, but it would do protection, but I kind of be conscientious on how I pair dogs up with clients.
Yeah.
Because while they on the road, you got the cleaning lady comes in.
It's true.
And you have Cuzzo that live on a couch and then you have, you know what I'm saying?
Little kids are,
it's a lot of irresponsibility going on.
Right, right.
So in hindsight, a lot of the people who do move a lot, is pretty much obedience.
Yeah.
Obedience trained mouse.
Yes.
Like that's the winning combo right there.
Yeah. I mean, because it gives you the illusion of, I'll do what it needs to do, but it also gives you the safety of.
Oh, there we go.
It also gives you the safety of not having a dog bite clean a lady or
exactly,
or you know, my sister or something like that.
So this isn't your first culture podcast.
This is great.
You're one a year
is
ago
so great.
Yeah,
that we saw on YouTube.
We looked it up on YouTube.
Okay,
and watched
Tony
the
Yayo?
Whole video.
Yeah. Shout out Tony Yayo.
And we were like, we are not getting in a suit.
I was like, I'm not wearing a suit. Yeah. These guys are so brave.
My question is, had those guys ever seen a dog like bite a suit before they volunteered for
it? Like what was going to happen?
All right. You know, the thing is, it's like they seen it online, I highly doubt they seen it in person, but it's a difference in person because it's like
a lot
it's,
different.
It's super live.
Yeah.
So that was actually a cool experience. It was an enlightening experience also because these guys, they don't be seeing trained dogs.
Mm-hmm. No.
Everybody just got like a dog running around the studio just jumping on everybody, and everybody gets tired of it. They just throw it in the crate.
Exactly.
So when they walked in, it was like 9-10 dogs in a downstay on the elevated surface, the mats that we utilize.
Yeah.
And they was just like, whoa. You know, it was pretty dope. It was enlightening for them too.
It was entertaining. Yeah. Especially the first guy, you brought like a little Mal.
Max.
Yeah, he wasn't even like scared of him until you bit him. And then it was like,
Yeah, that's
and that dog. Oh my god, his arm! I was like,
he was like, Darius.
Yeah,
yeah. That was actually shout out Max. Yeah.
What about Rick Ross? Does he still have his like big?
Yeah, I'm sure Rick Ross. I haven't dealt with Rick Ross.
It was a long time ago. Wow.
Yeah, yeah. Rest in peace, Black. Black was actually the one who bridged the gap between us and Rick Ross.
Really?
Yeah. So rest in peace, Black. But I'm sure Rick Ross had some dogs over there. When we was dealing with him, he had Doberman Pinschers.
Yeah, that's what it was. Yeah. I remember seeing that on your Instagram.
Yep.
I was like, that's the breed that I'm just always skeptical of.
Doberman.
Yeah.
That's something like the in their OG eyes.
Protection.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Our friend has. Maybe
it's because of where I grew up. Like that's Magnum PI. Like
for real?
Zeus and Apollo chasing Magnum PI.
And you got bit by one.
I got bit by one when I was a kid too. Yeah. So yeah.
Oh wow. Yeah.
I still think Rottweilers. I don't know. I'm even though they're like big lover dogs a lot of times. I'm so scared. After seeing Shaq, I will never look at a Rottweiler the same ever again because he was so, like, he wasn't fast because he was really big, but he was so strong. I was like, pressure. If this dog, like, gets you, you're not.
Game over.
You might not live. Yeah. Like,
See, my fear factor dog is, I guess we'd say Chow Chows.
Really?
Unpredictable.
Yeah. Emmy's part Chow. Well, her
she's
DNA
got a blue
tests.
Tongue.
Okay. Yeah. She got the purple tongue.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. She's a little unpredictable.
She'll
get
snap
you.
At you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not anymore because she's old, but
yeah. See, the Chows growing up, I guess my generation was the Chow phase.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everybody in the backyard. Everybody had a Chow Chow in the backyard, and then when they get loose.
Yep.
Honestly, if more dogs went through a training program, I mean, even the bare minimum, PetSmart.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The bare minimum, it'll be less dogs in the shelters and things like that. Because the reason why people get rid of dogs is they aren't able to communicate with the dog.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, and I said at the beginning, I mean, you know, getting Hutch and getting him trained changed our lives.
Yeah.
Like, Nikki was ready to leave. She wanted to move Atlanta. Yeah. Like, we live in downtown. Yeah. I had some bad experiences, well, and I was traveling all the time.
Yeah, he was going Monday through Friday.
And so that's why we got him, and it changed everything. Yeah. I mean, you know, it's there's a lot of power to it.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
Gives you a lot of confidence, like, walk around the neighborhood. And most even, definitely. Like, during the pandemic when things got, like, obviously everywhere, like, a little bit more heightened, I still felt, like, so safe having Hutch. And I'm like, I tell my girlfriends, I'm like, you don't need to, like, walk around with a gun. But if you walk around, even with, like, a small dog, people still, like, for the most part, as long as they don't think they can steal the dog and sell it, they're still not gonna like. You got one extra layer between most you definitely. And what people want to deal with.
Yeah,
and so I think it's just.
Yeah, I'm pro dog too. We
no, I had no idea.
Yeah, I'm pro dog.
What about Stone Mountain? You live in Stone Mountain?
Yes.
Okay. What are the places? Where should we go when we go to Stone Mountain?
Food, drinks.
Food, drinks.
Yeah. Mm. Maybe nowhere in Stone Mountain.
Yeah. That's
like,
what
where's
I'm saying.
The place you go all the time?
All right. So, look. All right. Let me do. All right. Okay. We got JJ's in Stone Mountain. Okay. You got Jerk Center that has the best jerk chicken.
Oh. Yeah.
That's in Stone Mountain. Yeah. Stone Mountain's known for the Caribbean, Caribbean vibe. So, if you want some Caribbean food, you got to go to Stone Mountain.
Yeah.
When I'm on the south side, I gotta go to Crab Pot. Shout out Crab Pot. Mm-hmm. That's actually to me the best seafood spot in Atlanta.
Mm. Huh. Crab so Pot.
Crab Pot.
Yeah, we've ridden by there.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Amazing.
Yeah. What before Nikki wraps up, what's the future of PK9? You got your training facility out there.
Like 10 years from now, what are you envisioning?
Still having a facility, doing more independent work. Out of the country, and in the country with different clients, being able to have forums, pretty much an auditorium, talking with people over like a 3-day period.
Yeah.
Pretty much enlightening them about the beginning stages of a dog puppy phase until the time that you have to make the decision for the dog to go into the afterlife. But I want to just do more of this.
Yeah.
More in, you know, more teaching.
Yeah, it's about being a thought leader.
Yeah.
And that knowledge being the critical element of what you do.
Most right? definitely. Most
yeah.
definitely.
Yeah. I appreciate that.
Well, this has been great. We really appreciate you coming here and spending time with us. It's been a while, so.
I know, that's what I'm saying. This is, and plus, this is like off the whim. This is like, that's what I'm saying.
That's the best conversations is the real ones. Those are the ones people listen to. What's the best way for people to find you? Is it Instagram?
Is that the best way that people find me is definitely through Instagram. My Instagram is PK9, High Power Pets. You can also find me on Facebook, PK9, High Power Pets. You can find me on Twitter, PK9 High Power Pet, not the S, PK9 High Power Pet.
I'll link all of it too. In the description.
Yeah, and then pretty much you could just ask anybody who had a dog who PK9 is, and I'll tell you exactly where
anyone
I'm at.
Anyone in Atlanta?
We located in 2916 Mountain Industrial, Tucker, Georgia. But we service people internationally and here domestically.
Thanks for coming. Cool.
Yeah, thank you so
much. Awesome, man.
Yeah.
Appreciate y'all inviting me, family. Yeah.
Thank you.
All right.
That's cool.
1, 2, 3 into the folks. Snoop Doggy Dogg and Dr. Dre is at the door. Ready to make an entrance, so back on up. Cause you know we're about to rip shit up. Give me the microphone first so I can bust like a bubble. Compton and Long Beach together, now you know you in trouble. Ain't nothing but a G-Bang, baby. Too low, death niggas, so we're crazy. Death Row is the label that pays, man. Unfadable, so please don't try to fake this. But back to the lake.